Assalaamu Alaikum and welcome to part 5 of the Halaal and the Haram Hadith Narrative. As I said in the past part, that people mistake the identity of being a Muslim. So what does it mean to be a Muslim? Even though people say, oh, it's to submit to Allah. But they don't do it really. Because when Allah states the term, be a Muslim, what he means, what Allah means is this. Be someone who submits to him through what he has said in his revelation. Be that the Torah for the Jews, or the Injil or Gospel for Christians, or the Quran for us, or for any other revealed book that he descended upon a messenger that was sent to another people. So when one says, when I say I am a Muslim, what I should mean and what you should mean is this. God's law, Allah's law, has reached me, and I have believed in it, and thus I will surrender to its orders, the do's and the don'ts. And as such, anyone who believes in God and acts accordingly on what that God, Allah, has revealed, good or bad, i.e. do the good and avoid the bad, is considered a Muslim. We today, we consider only those who follow Muhammad, follow the Quran, are Muslims, and this is a lie. This is the political Islam that says that. As far as Allah is concerned, as he said in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّمَا يُوحَى إِلَيْ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحَدٌ. Say, Ya Muhammad, to the people, that it certainly gets revealed to me that your God is just but one God. فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. So will you be of the Muslims? Will you be of the submitters to this God? You see, people have to believe that there is only one God, and this is the minimum part of Al-Islam. If someone believes there is a God, and act accordingly. If they don't kill, they commit the sins that humans do, but they know that there is a God up there and that they will meet him someday, accountability, things like that, then that they are called Muslims, submitters to that concept of the God. Are you a Muslim means, do you submit to what your God says? But nobody else, just the God. This is further clarified in another ayah, when Allah states, ordering us, the believers who believed in Muhammad and believe in the Quran, he orders us to say, وَقُولُوا آمَنَّ بِالَّذِي أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا وَأُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ. And say to the people, to the Jews, to the Christians, to everybody else, we have believed in what has been descended for us, i.e. the Quran, and what has been revealed to you. If I'm talking to a Jew, it's the Torah. If I'm talking to a Christian, it's the Gospel. And then, وَإِلَهُنَا وَإِلَهُكُمْ وَاحَدٌ. And our God and your God is one and the same. And then comes the beautiful thing that Allah says, وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ. And to him we all are submitters. I.e. if you, Jew, follow what the Torah says, to the best of what you understand it. And Christian, the same thing. You follow what in the Gospel, what says in the Gospel. And I follow what the Quran says, then we all are submitters, we all are Muslims to this God. Being a Muslim was never ever about saying the famous La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. That is not what it is meant. The meaning is much, much broader than what the political Islam that was invented by humans claims that that is what it is. You see, the political Islam was preached and spreaded around the world for centuries. I know the simple past of spread is spread, but you can, if you want to use spreaded, it is rare, but you can use it and there is nothing wrong with it. It's a non-standard variant of the word spread, but you can use it for great emphasis. So the sheikhs of the political Islam and the political sheikhs have preached and falsely spread it, that Muslim is only the one who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and this is a huge law. In order for a person to be a true submitter, They must submit to the law that they believe in. If you are a Jewish person, you must submit to the Torah and what it teaches. Not the Talmud, not to the other books that humans have invented, to the Torah, to the best of your ability, because with the, what people have done to it, a lot of mistakes. But you do your best at getting the message as you think is correct. The same thing for Christians, and the same thing for us. On Judgment Day, the messenger of Allah Muhammad and Moses and Jesus and all the messengers that Allah has sent to humanity will not, and I repeat, all these messengers, including Muhammad, will not, and I will repeat for another time, they will not intercede on behalf of their people for following something else than what they have brought. Moses is not going to go to Allah and says, "Ya Allah, please forgive them because they abandoned the Torah, please." No, he can't do that. And this is why for us, the believers, the Muslims, what we call us, on Judgment Day, Muhammad the messenger will not, and I will repeat again, will not thank the Sunnis for following his imaginary Sunnah. The messenger is not going to be happy, "Oh my God, I followed my Sunnah, these people are great, today I will intercede for them." It never will happen. And I call it imaginary Sunnah because that's exactly what it is. It's an imaginary thing. It doesn't have a substance. It doesn't exist. See, the messenger on Judgment Day, people, they say, "Oh, he will intercede for us." He will not intercede for you. Muhammad, if Allah didn't forgive his sins, the past and the future ones, would have been held accountable for so many wrong things he did. But anyhow, so the messenger on Judgment Day will and shall, and everything that will emphasize this act on Judgment Day, anyone who followed anything other than the Quran, he will be thrown under the bus. Muhammad will throw anyone who followed anything else but the Quran, will be thrown under the bus. As a matter of fact, he will openly accuse the Muslims, us today, of them betraying the message that Allah had sent to them. All the Muslims that followed Muhammad will be in a part. Muhammad will stand there and the Quran between Muhammad and them. Then the Prophet Muhammad will point to the Quran and he will say the most chilling, the most under the bus being thrown sentence that you'll ever hear. He will say, "وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ," and the messenger shall shout, "O Lord, Ya Rab, إِنَّ قَوْمِي," my people, the Arabs. Initially, it's because the Quran is for the Arabs, but now, because we believe and we are in Islam, everyone else will be part of that group of people. He will point at them and he will say, "My people, those who believed in me, اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا," they have taken this Quran, and he will point the Quran or he will hold the Quran, but the Quran won't be far from him. And then he will point to him and he will say, "Those people, they have taken the Quran, this Quran, as something to be deserted. They deliberately meant to desert and abandon the Quran." Yes, the nation that claims to believe in the messenger and the message he brought, the Quran, will be thrown under the bus on Judgment Day for deliberately declaring a continuous abandonment of the Quran. And you can see that today. You tell them Allah says in the Quran, and they tell, "But Rasulullah said, but that sheikh said, but the scholar said, the ulama said." That's it. The Quran is challenged by so many. My dear sisters and my brothers, this hadith narrative of the halal and the haram and the in-between is a huge example of such abandonment. As far as the Quran is concerned, that things are split into two categories. There is no third one. Either the halal or the haram. There is absolutely nothing in between. Watch how Allah Ta'ala has explained this and at the same time has attacked those people who appointed themselves as an authority with Allah. Watch what he says. وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبُ, and do not say to what your tongues falsely declare. What do these tongues, what the people declare? هذا حلال وهذا حرام. This is halal and this is haram. Allah classifies them as liars just by saying this is halal and that is haram. Why? لتفتروا على الله الكذب. For you to invent lies against Allah. I remember a time when people used to tell me Coca-Cola is haram. Haram. And I tell him, how can you say that? Is it said in the Quran? He goes, no, the Coca-Cola contains. Contains what? Contains what that makes it haram? And then they come to you, oh, and that is halal. How can you say that? But this is what Allah says. It is the tongues that falsely claim something that is halal and that is something and something that is haram. And by doing so, they have lied. Why have they lied? Simple. Because the act of saying halal and haram is only a right of Allah. The moment you open your mouth and you say that is haram, you have put yourself in the place of Allah and issued that statement. And this is extremely dangerous. And then Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Indeed, those who fabricate lies and attribute them to Allah will never, ever succeed. You see, therefore, as far as Allah is concerned, things are clearly labeled halal and haram. There is no such thing as ambiguous or unclear or unbetween and all that kind of stuff. There are so many ayat in the Quran that split whatever Allah has created into two categories, the halal and the haram. However, the sheikhs and the scholars and all these people, out of their own heads, went to complicate things beyond belief until the Islam that Allah has sent down cannot be recognized. And these scholars and sheikhs, with their long beards and the demeanor and how they talk and how they dress and all that kind of stuff, are just employed. They get their wages from the government. And as such, they preach what suits the government, what suits their school of thought, but never ever the Quran. And as such, they are pure fraudulent lies makers. And this is evident when you look at the number of things they out of their head have made haram for us. And I'll take one example, because I will get back, as I said, at the end and give you 40 other things that they have made haram for us, when in fact they are not. They tell you under the banner it is haram to resemble and mingle with the kuffar. That's it. They tell us that anything that comes from the kuffar is not permitted in Islam. They even say that it is a haram for a woman to have her hairstyle done and that resembles a lady from the kuffar, from the European kuffar. And if she does, then she has committed a sin. Why? Because now by doing their haircut and resembles the kuffar, she now resembles the kuffar, and resembling the kuffar is haram. This is an absolute lie, really an absolute lie. Allah in the Quran has never ever instructed us to isolate ourselves from the world and consider anyone else that is not following what we follow as a kafir. This is the product of the human hadithic Islam, not the divine Quranic Islam. Our scholars are liars. First off, Allah, as I said, never ever commanded us to isolate ourselves. In fact, Allah ordered us in the Quran to mingle with people from different nations. He ordered us and instructed us to learn from each other, to meet each other and humanity, exchange experiences for the well-being and the greater good of the humanity, work together for the well-being of the earth upon which we dwell on. And that's what Allah says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, those who have believed, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and do good deeds. The good deeds aren't for you to sit at home, subhanallah, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, and you perform your 5 daily prayers. That's not that. The good deeds is a broader term that expresses anything good that you do for the well-being of yourself and the humanity you belong too. When you invent a car, you have done something good. When you uphold the law, you are doing something good. When you give in charity, you are doing something good for the humanity. When you restrain yourself from committing crime and evil things, you're doing something good. And this is what Allah wants of us. Allah has never ever asked us to isolate ourselves. In fact, He commanded us to share the bounties with the entire human race. And this is clear in Surah Al-Hujurat. He tells us, we have created you from a male and a female. Why? So that you get in, and then He made us into groups, tribes, populations, and people around the earth. And then he says, لِتَعَارَفُوا, so that you get to know each other. Well, Allah didn't command us to isolate ourselves, hate everyone else just because they don't follow the Quran. That is the political Islam that was invented in the early days of Islam to legislate all the attacks on the neighboring countries. The Arabs took the sword and went conquering countries after countries until they went to Morocco. And they tell you the story of the big leaders, the generals that stood, that walked, that were took their horses and just went inside the ocean, and they drew their swords up in the sky. Ya Allah, if there is a land behind this ocean, I can't conquer it because I can't go there. And they tell you, look at these people, brave people. That's why we have so many terrorists in Islam. It's because of this human, political, hadithic Islam, not the Quran one. You see, when the Messenger of Allah was in Mecca, preaching to people how to be good and accept the Quran and things like that, at one point the Messenger started thinking to himself, oh, those people are the believers. He started dividing people into believers and non-believers. So Allah talked to him, and He talked to him in a very strong way. He tells him, that's not your duty to differentiate who is kafir and who is not kafir, because Muhammad, you don't know the ins and outs of humans. And then Allah revealed to him, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ ضَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ. It is surely your Lord. Look at that, your Lord, because He's directly addressing him. It is your Lord alone who knows best who has strayed from his way, i.e. didn't believe, and him alone, one more time, who best knows who is guided. Your Muhammad, your job is not to categorize people, it is just to deliver the message. But what did our men of religion, the scholars, the sheikhs, and all these people? They completely ignored Allah's ayat, that it's not our job to categorize people and all these things. And they went ahead and classified people, this is kafir and this is a believer. This is Darus Salam, this is the land of peace, and this is Darul Harb, and this is the land of wars, describing the land of the Kuffar. And that's why we have in our history, when they went and conquered Spain, and they did their best for Portugal, they went also for the southern parts of France, and Muslims are so proud of, one day we were just a few miles away from the southern parts of Paris. And I'm glad they didn't go to Paris. Really glad. But that shows you what the armies have done, what politics have done, what the imperial desires to expand has done. And today we're following that kind of Islam, the brutal Islam, the violent Islam. And then when people say Islam is brutal, bloodshedding, we go, oh my God, that's Islamophobia. No, this is our past talking. We're paying the prices for our past. And because we refuse to learn about the past and correct and say they were wrong, well, guess what? Our men of religion, the sheikhs, ensure that we remain ignorant of the past, and we cannot judge the past. And that's why they tell you the righteous predecessors for the love of Allah went through a civil war, and they kill each other without any mercy. In another ayah, Allah further refutes the misdeeds of these humans who divided things in a different manner than he did. He tells them, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مِنْ رِزْقٍ. Say, have you seen what Allah has sent down for you as a provision, food and everything else? فَجَعَلْتُمْ مِنْهُ حَرَامًا وَحَلَالًا. Then out of your own selves, divided it into a haram and a halal. Tell them, is it Allah that authorized you to do so? قُلْ أَلَّهُ أَذِنَ لَكُمْ. Have you been given permission by Allah to make this thing halal and to make that thing haram? Who authorized a sheikh to tell a woman that her style is haram or is halal? Who? And then Allah says, أَمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَفْتَرُونَ. Or do you fabricate with this classification lies on Allah? It's really, the Quran is so clear and so direct to the point. The sheikhs are deliberately ignoring it. And by ignoring it, they cause other people to ignore it as well. But for those people who have divided things and classified them in a manner that is not how Allah wants it, Allah threatens them and he says, وَمَا ظَنُّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And what do those who fabricate lies by making things halal and haram on the lies on Allah think will happen to them on Judgment Day? And you can find this ayah in Yunus, Surah number 10, the ayah number 60. That's why, my dear sisters and my brothers, classifying things into a halal and a haram is a no-no, unless you can substantiate it with an ayah from the Quran. If someone comes and asks you, can I marry my mother? You go, of course not. And they go, why? You say, because Allah says in the Quran, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ. Your mothers have been made haram on you. And if he says, what about my daughter? You say, وَبَنَاتُكُمْ also. And your daughters are also haram. Why? Because we have the text in the Quran clearly states it is haram. If someone comes to you and says, can I drive my car 60 miles an hour? You can't tell them, oh no, it's haram. Say, of course, it's up to you. That is your judgment. If someone comes and tells me, can I drive my car at 200 miles an hour? I cannot tell him it is haram to drive your car at 200 miles because I cannot substantiate it by an ayah from the Quran. There is no such thing in the Quran that says it is haram for you to drive your car at 200 miles an hour. However, I will tell them, Allah has stated in the Quran, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَ بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَ. And do not throw yourselves into destruction. Do not, and I mentioned the other ayah of do not kill yourselves. And I will tell this person, look, driving at 200 miles an hour, there is a risk for you to hurt yourself or even die. And Allah has prohibited that by saying this and this. So please don't drive at 200 miles an hour, because in case something happens to you, then you would have to answer, and the answer will not have an easy answer. The question, and then will not have an easy answer. So you see what I mean here? Never ever say something is halal or something is haram unless and until you have that in the Quran. In another ayah, Allah states this, kitabun, i.e. a book of law. And he's talking about the Quran. Uhkimat ayatuhu, which ayat, which is the content of the Quran, have been perfectly authored, i.e. the Quran is perfectly constructed. Then Allah says this, ثُمَّ. And then this ayat and the texts and the instructions in it, فُصِّلَتْ مِنْ لَدُنْ حَكِيمٍ خَبِيرٍ. They have been detailed, explained in detail by He, i.e. Allah, who is the ruler and the all-aware. The ruler and the all-aware. That's, if Allah is the one who rules and He knows how to rule, He's the judge and is all aware of our needs, and He says that He has detailed His instructions in the Quran, why then do we have the sheikhs, and why the Quran needs the sunnah? In other words, because the Quran is from Allah and the sunnah is from Muhammad, when they tell you the Quran needs the sunnah, what they're saying is Allah needs Muhammad more than Muhammad needs Allah. The Quran needs the Sunnah to be understood more than the Sunnah needs the Quran to be understood. In other words, Allah needs Muhammad to be understood more than Muhammad needs Allah to be understood. If this is not shirk, I don't know what is. You see, our sheikhs are quick to the draw. When they go to the Christian, they go, oh, these people are mushriks, they are kuffar. Why? Because they believe in God, the Father, Jesus, the Son, and Jibril, the Holy Spirit. You go, okay. And they forget themselves that when they claim that Allah is legislator number one, Muhammad is legislator number two, and the man of religion are legislators number three. It's incredible. In another ayah, Allah states, and He makes it even more clearer. He speaks to Muhammad, and He tells him, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ, and we have descended upon you the law, the book, the Quran, تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ, as a clarification to everything. And this ayah is Surah 16, and the ayah is number 89. They translate an-nahl by the bees, but it's not that. In Arabic, the term nahala is to gift somebody, is to give him somebody. And in Surah An-Nahl, even the scholars themselves, they say, that's the Surah of Al-Quran, while Allah mentions the bounties, the huge bounties that He has given to humanity. When Ibn Kathir came to explain the meaning of this ayah that doesn't need explaining, but he said, Allah has made clear to us in this Quran every knowledge of everything. One more time. Allah has made clear to us in this Quran every knowledge of everything. But what did our men of religion, the sheikhs and the scholars and school of thoughts and so on and so forth, what did they do? They totally ignored this ayah that Allah has described and explained and defined and clarified everything in the Quran. They completely ignored that, and they went ahead and said, the Sunnah rules over the Quran, but the Quran does not rule over the Sunnah. They say the Quran needs the Sunnah more than the Sunnah needs the Quran. Allah needs Muhammad more than Muhammad needs Allah. And I say, only losers would do such a horrible and sinister thing. Even though for the last 1400 years and a half that the believers have lived in the darkness and misery, that the misguidance that has plagued them is still plaguing us today up to 99.99%. And the Muslim world today, as always, hasn't seen anything of the light that exists in the Quran. And we need to put an end to this catastrophe. The amount of ayat in the Quran which establish that the Quran alone is sufficient book for us, that the Quran alone is our guidance. Don't Allah says that the Quran is a guidance? If the Sunnah is a guidance and Allah didn't mention it in the Quran, He has betrayed us, because the Sunnah is a guidance as well. If what the scholars say is a guidance and Allah didn't mention it in the Quran, Allah has betrayed us. But He didn't. Allah made the Quran and the Quran alone a book of guidance. And that's why He says, وَمَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, we have not neglected in this book, the Quran, anything. Nothing has ever been neglected. And this is in Surah Al-An'am, the Surah number 6, ayah 38. Nothing, absolutely nothing that Allah wants from us isn't explained in the Quran. On Judgment Day, my dear sisters and my brothers, just bear one thing in mind. When it's time for accountability, you will have your book of actions with you, and then you will go to stand before Allah for accountability. And then, when you get asked, you need to answer. And when you answer, your answer must not be far off the Quran. You cannot come to Allah on Judgment Day and you say, oh, the Hadith says, or the Ibn Taymiyyah said, or these people will run away on Judgment Day. If your father and your mother will run away miles from you, they don't want anything to do with you. If you, as a parent, will run away from your children, today you are willing to die for your children to protect them. Judgment Day, you will run away. You will flee from them. Do you think Al-Albani, Bukhari, Muslim, all these scholars will come and say, oh, yes, 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 Allah reported that hadith. They will run away. Even Allah in the Quran states that the people who were followed will run away from the people who followed. And then when they all meet in hellfire, those who followed started cursing those who they were following. On Judgment Day, you will not see the Quran there, and with it Bukhari, Muslim, Ibn Dawud, the other books. No. On Judgment Day, each nation will have the book that Allah has sent to it, and that is the law upon which Allah will judge people. So for me, I will stand in front of Allah with my book of action, and I will read what I done. And then everything that I done gets compared to the Quran, and the Quran alone. Not the hadith, not the sunnah. So what's not good on Judgment Day is certainly not good here. That's why Allah will tell you, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ آيَاتِي تُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ. Wasn't my ayat inside the Quran recited upon you? You didn't know that? And you cannot say, oh no, because today you are a believer. So why don't you read the Quran? Why aren't you researching what Allah says in Quran? Why aren't you studying what Allah says in On Judgment Day, there is no place and no space for the books of hadith, as I said, or books of scholars. The only book that Allah will exhibit on Judgment Day is the Quran, and the Quran alone. Allah states, وَلَقَدْ جِئْنَاهُمْ بِكِتَابٍ, and we have come to them with a kitab, i.e. manuscript that contains the law, the Quran. فَصَّلْنَاهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ, which we have upon the knowledge explained it in great details. Allah's knowledge of what humans can and cannot do and what we are capable of has made Allah the best at explaining what He wants of us. And then He says, this Quran is a guidance, hudan, and a mercy to a people who believe in the Quran. So this is the message that Allah has sent to the people of Mecca, to the Arabs and things like that. How these people respond to the Quran? Well, they didn't like it. They didn't accept it. They fought it in a variety of different ways. They did so many bad things to reject the Quran. And then from Allah presented the Quran to them nicely, He moves into the threatening mode. Look at how Allah threatens them. Look at how Allah threatens us. He says, هَلْ يَنظُرُونَ إِلَّا تَأْوِيلَهُ. Are they just waiting because they don't believe in the Quran, they're not following the Quran, they're not prioritizing the Quran? Allah says, why are they like this? Are they just waiting the fulfillment of its warnings, what Allah has warned in it? And then He says this, يَوْمَ يَأْتِ تَأْوِيلُهُ. The day its fulfillment comes to pass. يَقُولُ الَّذِينَ نَسُوهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ. Those who rejected it, i.e. the Qur'an, not them, not the Qur'an and the Sunnah, no, it. Allah is talking only about the Qur'an. Those who rejected it before, in this life, He means, shall say, قَدْ جَاءَتْ رُسُلُ رَبِّنَا بِالْحَقِّ. The messengers of our Lord did indeed come to us with the truth. لا إله إلا الله. Then the people are trapped. They want to get out of it. Allah says, and they will say, فَهَلْ لَنَا مِنْ شُفَعَاءَ فَيَشْفَعُ لَنَا. Are there any intercessors that would intercede for us to get us from this mess? Because now we are in big trouble. أَوْ نُرَدْ فَنَعْمَلَ غَيْرَ الَّذِي كُنَّا نَعْمَلَ. Or that we be returned to life, resurrect back in life, so that we act differently to what we did. I believe in the books of our Lord, in the message of our Lord. And then Allah issues this chilling statement, and He says, قَدْ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. They indeed have lost their own selves, i.e. from now until eternity comes to pass, and it will never pass, they have lost themselves. And how do they lost? i.e. they have no control from now on what gets done to them. وَضَلَّ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَفْتُرُونَ. And all that which they fabricated before shall leave them now, shall desert them now. You can read more about this in Surah 23, Al-Mu'minun, the Ayah 105. You see, there are many ayat in the Quran that state that the only authority in Allah's Islam is that of Allah. Nobody else has any right to say anything. After all, the Quran is the book that Allah has stated, وَبِالْحَقِّ أَنزَلْنَاهُ. i.e. the Quran was sent down with the truth. It contains the truth. وبالحق نزل, and with the truth it was descended. What Allah is stating is the Quran contains a truth that Allah wants from us, and Allah didn't send the Quran down as a play. In fact, it was sent down as a truth. The job of Muhammad or Musa or Isa or Dawood or Sulaiman or any other messengers, those we know and those we do not know, is simple. Their job description is one thing. They bring good news to the people who believe in what Allah has sent down. And they threaten and bring the bad news, and they warn people who do not or did not believe in Allah. Allah has never ever sent a messenger as a legislator. And this is clear in so many ayat in the Quran. For example, if you go to Surah Al-Isra, which is the surah number 17, and the ayah is 105, where Allah speaks directly to His messenger Muhammad. He tells him, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ, and we have not sent you, speaking to Muhammad, yeah, Muhammad speaking to you, we have not sent you except as an announcer of good news and as a warner. Just like Allah said in Surah Al-Kahf, that people read every Friday, wanting the good rewards, وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, and we do not send the messengers except as announcers of good news and as warners. Both Surah Isra 17 and Surah Al-Kahf 18 are of the early surah that were revealed in the early days of Islam. From the get-go, Muhammad knew that his job was just to announce to people the good news for those who believe and warn those who do not believe. And that's why for 13 years of his life in Mecca, nothing is written that he said, do this or don't do that, or it's halal. He didn't even teach his companions how to make wudu then. Why? Because Allah took care of that. But I don't know why we still hang on to this. There is a lot that I can speak here, but I want to end this talk with a story. A story that is reported in the Hadith narratives. And this is the conclusion. I want to close the talk here because there is more to talk, but it will take longer. But I want to end with this story here. When the messenger of Allah, as the books of history tell us, conquered Mecca, he went back to Mecca just a few days before he left, like a few months before he left. What happens was that some of them embraced Islam, the Arabs there, and many of them didn't, but that is another story. But there is a man called Adi. Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i. Hatim al-Ta'i is a well-known person with all the Arabs. Ask any Arab about Hatim al-Ta'i and he will tell you, oh yes, this is the most honorable, the most generous man in the Arabs. And they tell some story, incredible stories, really, about this man and how he would take care of his hosts and people and guests and things like that. This man, Hatim, has got a son, and Adi. Adi was a Christian man. When the Prophet Muhammad conquered Mecca, this Adi took off. He ran away from Mecca and fled. He was out in the wilderness for months. His wife, who loved him dearly, wanted to bring him back to the messenger. So she went to the messenger. She goes, Ya Rasulullah, Adi is scared of you. My husband is scared of you, and he is running away. If I brought him back, would you do him no harm? Of course, he said, I won't do you no harm. Why would I? So she took it upon herself to go and find her husband. And she did. And they say she went the right top, bottom. But at the end of the day, she found him. When she found him, she told him, look, Muhammad has said that he will not touch a hair from you. You sure? Yes, sure. What about the cross I'm wearing? She goes, nothing. He will not touch you. Okay. Adi goes back to her to Al-Madina. Adi now is in the same place as this messenger that he rejects, with the cross on his chest, but the Muslims didn't do any harm to him. But of course, these don't get talked around, but hey, that's what it is. And also, they don't tell you when the group of Christians of Najran came to a tribe of Christians came to visit Rasulullah, and when the time of Asr, before Maghrib, came for them to do their salat. And they don't tell you that the messenger of Allah asked the believers to leave the mosque, his mosque, and let the Christians pray inside his mosque. And when they prayed, they said, Jesus, Son of God, and Allah, the Trinity. But the messenger led them there. They don't tell you these stories. And this is in the last few months from the life of the messenger. It's not like at the beginning and then they tell you, oh, it's changed. No, this is towards the end of his life. But anyhow, back to Mr. Adi. One day, the messenger of Allah was reciting the Quran for a reason or another, maybe in Salat, maybe teaching, telling it to somebody. And Adi was not far from him. And he overheard the messenger of Allah reading the following ayah from Surah At-Tawbah. Surah At-Tawbah is the last surah of the Quran that was revealed to Rasulullah 3-4 weeks after that he died. The messenger of Allah was reading the following: اتخذوا احبارهم ورهبانهم اربابا من دون الله. They, speaking about the Jews and Christians, have taken their rabbis and their monks as gods, deities besides Allah. And this is in Surah At-Tawbah 09, ayah 31. When Adi heard this ayah, he didn't like it. So he commented, but Messenger of Allah, he didn't say Messenger of Allah, but the one who wrote the story, he's a believer, he said Messenger of Allah. But I assume the other one said Muhammad. But he said, but Muhammad, we never did worship them. We don't worship our monks. At which point the messenger answers, and look at his answer and what he said. It goes hand in hand with what Allah says in the Quran. He says, don't they, i.e. the rabbis and the monks, make haram what Allah has permitted, has made halal? Don't they prohibit you from doing something that Allah has permitted you to do it? And you follow them on that? Adi said, yes. And then the messenger carries on saying, and don't they make halal for you, permitted, what Allah has made haram, non-permitted, and you follow them on that? Adi said, yes, we do, but we don't worship them. And the messenger told him, that is their worship. And this hadith is authentic, reported by At-Tirmidhi, At-Tabarani, At-Tabari in his tafsir, Al-Bayhaqi, and few others. And the thing is, when Allah orders and you obey Allah, then guess what? You have worshipped Allah. When Allah says go east, and the hadith tells you to go west, and you go west, you have worshipped Muhammad. There is no other in betweens. Because if we try to justify us obeying Muhammad or obeying our scholars, then what the messenger of Allah said to Adi, that when your monks and rabbis change a law that Allah has established, then we can justify that. And then let's say there is no religion, we might as well turn atheists. You see, the title of messenger, being the messenger of Allah, is nothing more and nothing less than being just an envoy somebody Allah sent with a message. That's it. Think of it this way. If a postman brings a bill to you, who pays the bill? It's you. It's not the postman, it is you. If you have an invitation to a wedding and the postman brings a letter to you and delivers it to you, who goes to the wedding, you or the postman? Who decides on what you're gonna wear, you or the postman? Who decides what time you leave your house, you or the postman? Who decides on what gift you're gonna buy, the groom and the bride, you or the postman? You get the idea. See, when Allah sends a messenger, the job of the messenger is to be like a relayer. Think of a messenger as such. If you have a microphone in your hand and the amplifier is at the other end of the room and you need to connect the mic with a cable to the amplifier so that your sound gets transmitted from the microphone to the amplifier, the messenger in all this is the cable. He is the cable. So when Allah speaks to us in the microphone, the messengers transmit the message through the cable, and we are the receivers, the amplifiers, and then it's up to us to do what we need to do with that message. This is why, if Muhammad was part of this Islam, he should never ever have died. He must have stayed, because we need him today more than they needed him back then. We need him today to sort out the mess that we are in. And this is why when Allah was talking to those who believed, and Allah knew these people would do to the Quran what the Jews and Christians did to the Bible, and tell them, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ And Muhammad, as far as Allah is concerned, illa Rasul, is nothing but a messenger. He is not the best of creation. He is not the most beloved of Allah. He is not at the top of the chain of messengers. No, he is just a messenger. قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. So many other messengers before him have come, died and gone. Meaning he will also die, finish his message and be gone. If Muhammad is just a messenger, not a legislator, how, who gives him the authority to say this is halal and that is haram, and in between them there is good and bad? All these are lies of the sheikhs. Someone evil, somewhere in the past, has fabricated this evil hadith narrative and injected it in Islam. And then he went ahead and created a chain of narrator. Remember that sheikh who said when the people of Al-Madinah had an argument, he used to make a hadith for them to top one side over the other? Like him, there are thousands. And unlike him, we don't know of these thousands. Muhammad as a messenger does not have any authority to interfere with what Allah's Islam is or isn't. And so much less the sheikhs. They are not the inheritors of prophets. They are not the people that the humanity needs them, and they don't need humanity. Scholars are nothing but people who can point us back to the Quran. When you go to a sheikh, don't ask him, is it halal or haram? Ask them, what does Allah say about this in the Quran? Exclude him from the equation. Exclude Muhammad, the messenger, from the equation. Exclude Moses. Exclude Jesus. Exclude. You gotta exclude everybody else, and you gotta stay tight with Allah. You see, Muslims, the believers, us, we have the biggest mouths on earth. We tell people Islam is the truth, and it indeed is the truth for us. Just like to Christians, the truth to them is the gospel. And between us and them, we should قُلْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءً بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ. Come to an equal word that is between us and between you. What is this equal word, Ya Allah? أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا إِلَى. That you, Christians, and us, believers, and the Jews, we only believe one God. Allah states these things in the Quran. Nobody talks about them. But we go to the world, Islam is the only truth. Judaism is not the truth. Gospel Christianity is not the truth, they say. Islam brings happiness and good life to people. Where is the happiness when someone jumps in a van and drives on a pavement and kills civilian kids and women and guys? What is the happiness in that? Where is the happiness when Daesh, ISIS, puts a prisoner, a Muslim prisoner, in a cage and set him alive with fire? Where is the happiness that Islam brings in cutting people's hands? Where is the happiness if a person commits a mistake, a young girl goes and sleeps with another man and she gets stoned to death? I've seen this video on YouTube and it broke my heart. ISIS dug a hole for her and her dad was there. A stupid man was there. And the girl was thrown rocks upon. And people were engaging in stoning her to death, each one. And believe me, the guys were throwing the rocks with all the strength they have. Even some of them had big rocks, throw them on the girl. And the girl was crying, Abby, Dad, I'm really sorry. I am really sorry. But he was like a rock to her until she got murdered. And then he feels himself, he's accomplished Allah's law. Why is there repentance? Why is repentance there? Why does Allah in the Quran states that, Ya قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Say, Ya Muhammad, Ya Quran, say to the people who have indulged in sin excessively, لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not lose hope from the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ, certainly Allah is capable. يَغْفِرَ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. He forgives all sins, all of them sins, Allah can forgive them. On Judgment Day, Jesus will stand in front of Allah and Allah will ask him, Ya Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus son of Mary, have you told people to worship you and your mother and be taken as deities apart from me? Isa will say, no, I never told them that. I told them only what you told me to tell them. to worship but one God. Okay? And then Jesus said, and as long as I was alive, I did tell them that. Then when I died, you, Ya Allah, were the supervisor over them. You know what happened to them and how they got distracted and deviated from the right path. And then Allah says, Al-Yawm Yanfa'u As-Sadiqina Sidqa. Today, the people who spoke the truth back in time, their truth will serve them well today. I.e., Jesus, you spoke the truth. And then Jesus added something beautiful. Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Hey guys. If you forgive them, you are the very forgiver, you are the top forgiver, you are the most forgiver. And if you punish them for associating with you, then you are fair and just. You know what Allah said? Allah rejected the punishment and kept quiet on the forgiveness. Not every Christian in the street that says Jesus, Son of God, is going to hellfire. Because only Allah knows what goes in our hearts and why the people are the way they are. Allah has stated in the Quran, we cannot be gods and say this man will go to Jannah and that will go to hellfire. We've got some stupid invented things. If somebody, when somebody dies and if there are so many rows, 10 or 14 or 40 even, and they pray on him and they say good things about him, he will go to paradise. This is a lie. Allah said in the Quran, every soul shall come on judgment day to defend itself. Each soul will be held accountable. There is no guarantee to anyone to go into paradise, no matter how many people pray for them. But the Islam that we have today brings happiness to people. And just like I said to somebody, I said, have you looked at the Muslim world today? 1,400 and almost 50 years. Show me the happiness, dictatorship, lack of freedom of expression. Women cannot venture out of their homes after sunset. But anyhow, as I promised before, I'm going to mention now the 40 elements that are halal, but the sheikhs have made them haram. I start by saying, I'll do this in the coming talk, inshallah, in the next part, number 6. Again, this is your brother, Abdus Salam, about the halal and haram.